Good morning, Vandal. Let me recall that digital communications course once. What is the minimum error decoder? Which of the following is the minimum error? ML decoder or maximum a posteriori probability decoder? Can you try to recall this one? Which will try to give the minimum average probability of error in your digital communications course? Maximum likelihood decoder or maximum a posteriori probability decoder? Which one? Even we revised, right? This is optimal by default. MAP decoder is optimal, which will try to provide minimum error for your classification or for your decoder. Minimum error. Okay, let me consider classes like omega 1, omega 2, and so on, omega c. There are total c classes. C different classes. For example, this is an example. For example, consider omega 1 corresponds to cats, omega 2 corresponds to dogs, and so on, omega c corresponds to monkeys. There are total C different classes, C different categories or classes. We are calling category 1 as omega 1, small omega, category 2 as omega 2, and so on, category C as omega C, small omega C. We have total C classes, and let me have the prior probabilities for them. P of W1, P of omega 1, P of omega 2, and so on, P of omega C. Here are the prior probabilities. Then what is this one? Sigma equal to 1 to C, P of omega I. What is this value? These are the prior probabilities for my distribution. Then what should be the sum of these probabilities? What is this? Yeah, again, respond. What will be some of the probabilities? Discuss first the probability of occurrence of class omega 1, probability of occurrence of omega 2, and so on, probability of occurrence of class omega C in your particular data set. Let's assume that you have only these classes in your data set, in your overall data set. Then what should be the probability of occurrence of any one of them? That is same as this, right? Then what should be the sum? The total probability, right? It should be equal to 1. And all of them are probabilities. So that they belong to 0 to 1 interval. These are the probabilities, right? And the total probability should be equal to 1. These are called as prior probabilities. Probability of occurrence of omega 1, probability of occurrence of omega c, this one. And let me have some other notations. Posterior probabilities. Or before that, let's go to likelihood. Likelihood functions corresponds to, yeah, one of you can answer, what can be your likelihood functions? corresponds to probability density functions. This is x bar after w1 omega1 and so on. Here the giant probability density functions. Where x bar is d cross 1 vector. For example, you can consider x bar equals to x1, x2 up to xd. It's a d-dimensional vector, feature vector. This is a probability density function for class 1. It's a probability density function for class omega c, class 1 and class c. Here the probability density functions, PDFs. And once again, area under this curve is 1 and area under this curve is 1 because these are the probability density functions. This is the input feature vector. Our target is someone will try to provide you with some observation x bar, which is d cross 1 vector, and our classifier should give the output corresponds to this class. This can be either omega 1 or omega 2 or answer omega c. So one out of these c classes. It's a classification task, right? Classification. This is your input. Someone will try to give this d-dimensional feature vector, and based on that particular feature vector, you need to classify whether that particular data corresponds to class 1 or class 2 or class C. That's the target for you. For that, we are trying to go for the minimum error classifier. Minimum error classifier means, exactly similar to your digital communications optimal decoder concept. Both are exactly similar. Which corresponds to maximum a posteriori probability classifier. Maximum a posteriori classifier means we'll try to consider as follows. Are they given input? Yeah, one of you can answer, is it probability density function or probability mass function? This one. Is it density or mass? Let's go back to this one. These are the mass, probability mass. And these are the density functions. Likelihoods are the density functions. These are the mass. Mass means discrete. It's a continuous space. X is continuous. X can take continuous values. X1, X2 up to HD can be any real values. These can be any real values. It's a continuous space. That's why you're going for PDF, probability density function. These are the discrete, right? You are having total C different classes. These are the discrete, just C classes, right? Then you can call them like probability mass. The probability densities, integration for this one should be 1, summation for this one should be 1, when that is discrete. And what about this? Is it probability or is it a probability density function, this thing? At least you can try, right? Yes, one of you can try that. Is it density or mass? See, this particular course is really helpful for your placements. If you interact, you can learn more. Is it density function or quality mass function? This one. See, probability mass function. It's not density. And this is a posteriori probability. That's the reason I'm calling it like probability, right? You want to consider the class which will have maximum a posteriori probability for the given data x bar. That's what your target. Someone will give you some input x bar and they'll ask you to identify what is the corresponding class. Then what you are going to do is you'll simply try to substitute that x bar into each of these a posteriori probability distributions. And whichever is trying to give the maximum, you'll try to consider that class and the label for that one. In that way, you try to decode. Implies omega I star is the classifier output. You are trying to maximize this one. You are trying to see which class is trying to provide maximum value for this a posteriori probability. You are simply varying this one, omega 1 to omega c. Suppose omega 2 is giving maximum when compared with remaining c minus 1 values, then you'll try to have I star equals to 2. And this will become like omega 2. Your output of your classifier will be omega 2 in that particular example. That's what we are doing here. It's a minimum error classifier. Can someone try to simplify this? Maximization of probability of X bar. Okay, what is this? Yeah, the classes, right? Where J ranges from 1 to C, right? J belongs to 1 to C. There are total C classes. Can someone apply Bayes' rule for this? If you apply Bayes' rule, what will be this? See, I'm expecting response from you. I read the hints also. We have these probabilities. Prior probability we are having, and we are having the likelihood functions also. Fx bar of x bar after omega g. Then how to find this with the help of Bayes' rule? What should be this one? The maximization of this one is same as maximization of probability of omega g, omega j into fx bar of x bar after omega j. This is a likelihood function divided by fx bar of x bar. Maximization of this one is same as maximization of this one. These two are identical. Is there any problem if I remove this? See, you should respond. Otherwise, there's no use, right? Is there any problem if I remove this term?
No, sir.
Why? Why there's no problem?
Because that is constant for all the values.
Yes, this is
All the
constant for all j, right? This is
yes.
independent of the index j. We want to find the constant j. independent of index j. This is simply like a constant term,
Yes.
and which is positive. This is non-negative, right? Because it's a PDF, probability density function, giant PDF. This is some non-negative quantity. If you remove this one, still that is same as maximization of this one. The two are identical. For the same class omega I star, you are going to get the maximum value for same class omega I star. If you maximize this one, or if you maximize this one, we are going to get the same class omega I star at the end, where I star is the optimal, omega I star is the optimal. Okay, that's fine. Do you think maximization of this one is same as maximization of this? Or any mistake in this? In this point, this is natural logarithm, log base e. Maximization of this one, there's something similar to this one. Maximization of this one, is it okay? Is it okay or any problem? Maximization of this and this. For example, consider some function f of x, which is always non-negative. F of x greater than 0, some function f of x. And let's say, this one example. Let's say you are getting the maximum value instead of real space. Let's consider some set, some interval like that. Over this interval, you are getting maximum value at x star. At x star, f of x star is the maximum. Then do you think ln f of x also max at x star? Is it true or false? Can you respond? See, f of x is maximum at x star. Then what about ln f of x? Is it maximum at x star once again? Is increasing function or decreasing function? Ln f of x. Is it increasing function or decreasing function? Logarithm function. Ln of something, some x for example. If you increase x, will it increase or decrease?
Increase.
That will increase, right? This is an increasing function, strictly increasing function. If you increase x, that will increase. So we can claim the same, right? If this is maximum at x star, definitely this is also maximum at x star. Ln f of x also. These two are same, right? That means maximization of this one is same as maximization of this one. These two are identical. There is no difference. Which I can try to expand like this. That implies maximization of ln p of wj plus, I'm simply writing ln xy equals to ln x plus ln y. This is log base e. Natural logarithm. That is same as maximization of this one. Let me call this like discrimination function. Discrimination function g of x bar equals to ln p of wj plus ln x bar of x bar after w j. See, called as discrimination function. See, there's a meaning in this, right? This is an English word. And I try to guess what, why we are calling it like discrimination function. What the reason? Why? You know the meaning of discrimination, right? That English meaning. What is discrimination means? It is a discrimination function which is trying to differentiate which x corresponds to which class. This is helpful for the decision making. Indirectly, what you are doing here is you want to do this x bar I star equals to r max of gj of x bar. That's what your target. You want to see for what value of j this particular function is maximum for this given x bar. That particular j corresponds to I star implies omega star is the particular class, omega star, I star is the label. Label or class or category. Or given input x bar. This is what you are trying to do with the help of this discrimination function. This is helping for discrimination purpose, right? Between classes. That's why I'm calling it like a discrimination function. Can I call this one as a discrimination function? You can answer probability of probability of x. Can I call this like discrimination function? The definition of discrimination function is that should be helpful to segregate different classes, right? To separate different classes. Can I call this as a discrimination function? Is it helpful for discrimination? See, one of you can answer. The Sai
yes,
Kumar is there, right? Yeah, that's a discrimination function. Okay, why? Why you are calling it like discrimination function?
Because we have derived this from that itself, sir.
Yes. We started from there only, right? We are trying to maximize this one. Whichever J is trying to maximize this one, the concerned class we are considering at the output of your classifier, right? That's what we are doing here. Still, you can call it like a discrimination function. If I want, I can multiply this one with some constant, some positive constant. Still, I can call it like a discrimination function, right? You can manipulate this, there is no problem at all. Still, this is a discrimination function. You can call it like discrimination function. Okay, let me consider some example where you are having C classes, omega 1, omega 2, and so on, omega C. C different classes. And the concerned prior probabilities are P of omega 1 and so on, P of omega C. They are the concerned prior probabilities. And the likelihood functions f x bar of x bar after omega 1 and so on, f x bar of x bar after omega c. These are the likelihood functions. And let's assume that these things follows Gaussian. Let's assume that these things follows jointly Gaussian distribution. We're trying to model these distributions, probability density functions, like a Gaussian distributions. Your data follows roughly Gaussian. That particular example we considered. Yeah, one of you can answer. What is Gaussian distribution? Yeah, forget about this. What is jointly Gaussian distribution? X bar of X bar. Where X bar is d-dimensional vector, feature vector. Like that you can consider. D cross 1 vector. Can you just tell me this probability density function for this? The PDF for the giant Gaussian. 1 by? See, if that is Gaussian single variable, if that is basically Gaussian with single variable, then that will be 1 by root 2 pi sigma square into e power minus x minus mean whole square divided by 2 sigma square, right? It's a Gaussian density function. If that is jointly Gaussian random variable, this is a d-dimensional vector, then that will be 1 by root 2 pi whole to the power of d, or you can say 2 pi whole power d by 2, 1 by root 2 pi whole power d into root mod sigma, capital sigma, this is capital sigma, this is small sigma. Then what will be this? Yeah, one of you can fill this. Yes, what is this? E power minus x bar minus mu bar transpose into sigma inverse into x bar minus mu bar and anything left divided by, you can compare with this, right? Some sort of similarity there, divided by 2. 1 by root 2 pi whole power d, root mod sigma, e power minus x bar minus mu bar whole transpose, sigma inverse x bar minus mu bar. Then what about mu bar? What is mu bar? What is the dimension of this? What is the dimension of mean vector? Input vector dimension is d cross 1. Then what is the dimension of this mu bar? Yeah, one of you can respond. Mu bar also d cross 1, right? Mu bar is simply mean of this one, x bar, where x bar is d cross 1. Then what about covariance matrix? It's a mean vector. Can you just tell me what is the covariance matrix sigma? Expectation of x bar minus mu bar into x bar minus mu bar whole transpose. This is a covariance matrix. Then what is the dimension of this? It's a matrix. See, this dimension corresponds to D cross 1. The dimension of this transpose is 1 cross D. And what is the dimension of this sigma? 3D cross T, right? So D cross T dimension. Yeah, this is a covariance matrix. Here, our assumption is each of these likelihood functions are jointly Gaussian. Let me consider ith one. Let me consider ith class. Let's go with the same notation, jth class. Let me consider jth class. And what I'm saying is, the likelihood function of this one is the likelihood function for the jth class, where omega j, this follows jointly Gaussian with the mean vector mu j bar and covariance matrix sigma j, capital sigma j, where this corresponds to d cross 1 and this corresponds to d cross d. The dimension of this vector and matrix is a covariance matrix, is a mean vector. This will be different for different classes. J equals to 1, 2, and so on. C. There are C classes. For the class 1, this will be mu 1 bar. And for class 2, this will be mu 2 bar. For class C, this will be mu C bar. Replace index J with the concerned thing. This is our assumption. This is our assumption that the data for each and every class follows jointly Gaussian in nature. That's the assumption we considered. Now let's try to see how to do discrimination. Can you recall what is our discrimination function? Our target is this one, right? We want to maximize over this. I star equals to argument. Implies omega I star is the concerned class label for given input x bar d cross 1 vector. This is your target. Can you just give me one of the discrimination functions? We derive something, right? After applying map rule, minimum error discrimination function. What is minimum error discrimination function? The same as map rule, right? We are trying to apply map rule. We are trying to maximize this one. A posteriori probability omega j after x bar. This one is same as finally we ended up with this, right? Ln p of wj plus ln likelihood function. It's a likelihood function if x bar of x bar after knowing that this is from omega j. We call this as a discrimination function finally, right? After some manipulations, let's consider this as a discrimination function. Let's start somewhere here. Equals to ln p of wj plus ln x bar of x bar after wj. This is our discrimination function. And we want to maximize this. This is our target. Okay, if you try to apply natural logarithm for that one, what we are going to get? Ln for this. Yeah, can someone answer? This is your discrimination function. Try to substitute this into this expression, this value. It's a Jahn-Lee Gaussian, right? What will be this? Ln p of wj plus, this is some value, some constant value, probability of omega j, prior probability. Yes, Vashin, what is natural logarithm for this? Let me rewrite once again. I'm writing twice. This is just a notation. If you want no one to write this one, you can write it directly here. That's your wish. There's no problem at all. One by root 2 pi whole power d. If this is d dimensional, x bar d cross 1 whole power d into root mod sigma I. It's a determinant of sigma I, covariance matrix. Determinant of sigma I, capital sigma I, and e power minus x bar minus mu I bar transpose into sigma I inverse into x bar minus mu I bar divided by 2. Okay, if you apply logarithm for this, then what you are going to get? Log of this. See, ln of ABC, what is this? Can you expand this? You should respond, and then only that's good. What is ln ABC?
ln A plus ln B plus ln C.
Okay, ln A plus ln B plus ln C, right? ln A plus ln B plus ln C. We'll like to do the same thing. We can consider this as A. We can consider this part as A. And consider this part as B. And this part as C. Then what will be this? This is 2 pi whole power d by 2. 2 pi whole power d by 2. And ln 1 by x is same as minus ln x. That's minus ln x, right? Then you are going to end up with this minus d by 2 ln 2 pi, this part. And you see ln once again 1 by x kind of thing, minus ln. See, you know this, right? Ln a power x equals to x ln a. That's what I'm doing here. Argumentation a power b equals to b ln a minus 1 by 2. This is determinant of sigma I whole power 1 by 2 and 1 by something, right? Then this will become like determinant of sigma I whole power minus 1 by 2, and if you apply log for that, minus 1 by 2 ln determinant of sigma I. Then what next? Yeah, one of you should answer this term. What is logarithm for this? Natural logarithm, ln of this. What is ln e power minus b?
Minus B.
Minus b, right? Okay, that's fine. This part will become minus x bar minus mu I transpose sigma I inverse x bar minus mu I bar divided by 2. Now this will be my discrimination function. This one I want to maximize. I want to construct the class which will try to maximize this discrimination function. That's what my target. Okay, here is this one, right? By 2 ln mod sigma I. Yes, what is this? Minus x bar minus mu I bar transpose sigma I inverse is power exponential, right? Divided by 2, whether it's right. And maximization of this particular GJ bar of X is same as maximization of, can you remove some of them?
D by 2 ln 2 because
Why?
that is constant.
This is constant, right? This is constant with respect to J. Index J. For any j, this is always constant. No need to consider this term. Then remaining part you can write. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, can you remove further any one of the terms? We can't remove now. This can be written as minus 1 by 2 ln mod sigma I minus x bar minus mu I with j, right? We are following notation j. Replace I with j everywhere. Say j. X bar minus mu j transpose sigma j inverse x bar minus mu j divided by 2. Maximization of this one is same as maximization of this one. They do are same. And I want to find the concerned class based on this. That's what my target. I star equals to arg max of this one. I want to see whichever j is giving maximum for this particular function. That one I can consider it like I star implies omega I star is optimal class for given x bar. In this case, optimal in the sense minimum error, because we started with a posteriori probability, right? Omega star is the minimum error classifier output. This is your target. This is our final discrimination function. If you want, You can call this as our updated estimation function. This can be called as gj of x bar. Is updated discrimination function. You want to maximize this. Okay, let's simplify this further. Okay, let me try to consider. Sigma j equals to sigma square I for all j. What is the meaning of this? What is this? Sigma square I means. See, I means identity matrix. All diagonals are ones. And remaining everything else are zeros in this. Zeros here and there. The D cross D. The identity matrix. Sigma square I means you are going to have all these elements as sigma square. Equal variance for all features. Let's consider case one as follows. There are total D features. For each and every feature, this is our feature vector x1 up to xd. There are total D features. Each and every feature is having a variance of sigma square, equal variance according to this. And covariance is zero, right? And this is also given. Xi minus mu, okay, mu I we are already following, right? Yeah, you can map this, no problem. I don't want to give confusion for you. See, the meaning of this one is the covariance between x1 and x2 is 0. Covariance between x1 and x3 is 0. Covariance between x1 and xd is 0. The cross covariance is there, right? The covariance term is 0 for them. If that is jointly Gaussian, and all cross covariance terms are zeros, then what is the meaning of that? What is the meaning of this? We have a test also, right? Quiz one. Is it independent or not?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Jointly Gaussian and covariance matrix is sigma square I implies they are independent. Independent features. All these features are independent. There is no dependency between these features or the D variables. That's what the indirect assumption we have considered for this case. With this assumption leads to independent features. Okay, if you try to substitute this particular thing into that expression, then what you are going to get? See, and vary and mean is different. You will have mu j equals to 1 to 1 7 c. Mu j is not equals to mu. Mu j, that mean can be, mean vector is different for different classes. Only this covariance matrix is identical for all classes, this covariance matrix, but mean vector is different for different classes. Now, what's going to happen if you try to substitute into this expression? You see our final result, right? Minus 1 by 2 ln mod sigma j. Then what is this? What is mod sigma j based on this? What is determinant of this? Determinant of this. See, product of diagonal elements, right? If this is a diagonal matrix, determinant of this one is same as product of diagonal elements. Sigma square into sigma square into and so on into sigma square d times. Shall be sigma square whole power d, which will be equals to sigma power d for all j equals to 1 to c. For everyone, sigma j is same as sigma square I, right? Sigma power 2d. We can try to replace this with sigma power 2d, right? This one. And we are done with this part. And this part is remaining. Yeah, can someone tell what is that? Minus half. See, if you try to practice, then you can remember. This is just for your practice. Yeah, what is that? X bar minus mu j bar transpose into sigma j inverse. Yes, let me try to rewrite this somewhere here. Then what is sigma inverse here? Sigma inverse, sigma j inverse. What is the inverse of this diagonal matrix? This one, right? If that is diagonal matrix, that's fairly straightforward for us. If you want, you can multiply this one with this one, this matrix and this matrix, we are going to end up with I. You can just cross check. I'm just taking the inverse for the diagonal elements. That is same as sigma j inverse, 1 by sigma square I. I replace this one with I by sigma square, where I is identity matrix. Then what is the simplified version of this? Yes, at least you can answer now. What is this multiplication? This part. See, if you multiply something with identity matrix, what you are going to get?
Same matrix.
Same thing, right? You are going to end up with the same this row vector only, x minus mu j bar. The multiplication of this one leads to x bar minus mu j bar transpose. Replace this one with this one. And then, yeah, what will be this? Can I say like this? X bar minus mu j bar norm square by sigma square. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
I can say like this, right? X transpose x equals to norm x bar square. See, L2 norm. L2 norm square. I have just written in that particular form. That's only. Yeah. Then what will be this part after simplification? So it becomes like that 1 by 2 factor is there, right? We are going to get minus of norm x bar minus mu j bar square divided by 2 factor into sigma square, the sigma square. Yeah, this is the final thing we got with this. Is there any simplification further? You can think. Okay, this can be removed, right? Because that's independent of J. 1 by 2 ln sigma power 2d. What I can do is I star equals to arg max of ln p of omega j. This particular term is not function of j, it's constant with respect to j. I can remove this term and I can keep only this term. Minus 1 by 2 sigma square into norm x bar minus mu j bar whole space. This term I got finally, implying the constant omega I star is the optimal or minimum error classifier output, that omega I star. Suppose, let me go for one more assumption. J. Then what will happen? All are equally probable. I just consider the case where all the classes are equally probable. Prior probabilities are equal for them. In that scenario, what will happen?
You can remove that term.
You can remove this term, right? First, suppose if this is true, then I star equals to R max J. I can remove this term because this is constant. 1 by c is a constant with respect to this j. I can remove this and I can have only this term. Minus 1 by 2 sigma square norm x bar minus mu j bar whole square. Oh, can I do any further manipulations over this? Is there any problem if I remove this term? Is it okay or any problem? I just removed this term.
Yes, sir, it is okay.
That's okay, right? Because this is positive constant. Variance is always non-negative, right? This is a positive constant. I can remove this positive constant outside this. If this is negative, I should not remove. Because maximum will become like minimum, right? If I replace negative, if I remove that negative part. It's a positive multiplication factor. I can remove this without any doubt. And I can have this and implies I star equals to R max. Is it true or false? Is it true?
It's minimum.
It's a minimum, right? Because this minus sign is there. See, maximization of minus f of x is same as minimization of f of x. These two are same. You can try to make it like minimization. It's not max, it's min. Yeah, now what is the intuition behind this? Are you finding any intuition? I'm writing this final statement. Omega I star is the output class label for a given input feature vector x bar with minimum error classifier. And what are the other conditions we considered? There are so many constraints, right? There are so many assumptions. We consider the likelihood functions as jointly Gaussian. With equal covariance matrix for all j, sigma square I. And equal prior probabilities, P of wj equals to 1 by c. Okay, let me rewrite somewhere. And this is one more assumption we consider, right? 1 by c for all j. They are equally probable. With these conditions, we end up with this particular classifier, finally. Minimum error classifier with these assumptions. This corresponds to equal prior probabilities. Can you say, can you call it like a Euclidean distance? If I remove this two, can I call it like Euclidean distance? Okay, one more thing. Can I write like this? Or any mistake is there in this? Can I write this one like this? This particular square I am removing. Is it okay? What is this max or min? This min, right? Let's see. Is it true or false? Minimization of x, this is f of x whole square. Okay, forget about this. F of x, you are getting minimum at x star. Implies minimum for f of x whole square also at x star. Let me go in this way. Is it true or false? This way might be false. Whatever this, is it true or false? At x star, I am getting the minimum for f of x whole square. And at same x star, I am going to get the minimum value for f of x. Is it true or false? Oh, that's true. I can write like this also. What is the name of this? Euclidean distance, right? For example, yeah, just for your convenience, I'm going to show you this. Let me say x bar equals to x1, x2, d cross 1, right? And this mu j vector equals to mu j 1, mu j 2, and so on. Mu j d. This is also d cross 1 vector. Then what will be this expansion equals to? X1 minus mu j1 whole square plus and so on xd minus mu jd whole square. This is the Euclidean distance, right? It's a Euclidean distance. See, if you have doubt, you can just substitute our earlier thing. X bar minus mu j bar transpose into x bar minus mu j bar. This we came from there only, right? We got from here only. X bar minus mu j bar transpose into x bar minus mu j bar. It's an Euclidean distance between x bar and mu j bar. Now, is it mapping to your intuition? One of you can answer what you are getting from here. Can you call it like this? Minimum distance classifier. Is it okay to call it like a minimum distance classifier or not okay?
Yes, sir. It is okay.
Minimum distance, right? Because you are trying to minimize the distance. This is a mean. Yeah. Mean of that particular class, jth class. Suppose my input x bar is nearer to jth mean, then I will call it like class, my classifier might be omega j. Like that I will say. Just for understanding purpose, let me consider some graphical example for this. Is it looking like circular shape? Circular shape. Do you agree? Is it circular shape or not? There is a reason for considering like circular shape. This is feature 1. This is feature 2. Let me consider x bar equals to x1, x2. It means I considered d equals to 2. My feature vector dimension is 2. D equals to 2. Just for understanding, visualization purpose. So that this can go up to xd, d means 2, right? X1, x2, the feature vector. And there are the concerned classes. Each color corresponds to different class. And variance is same, right? Variance means the distribution should be same for these. Almost the size should be similar, right? The variation. There are three classes in this particular example. The dimension of that input vector is 2 cross 1. There are two features, x1 and x2 are the two features. Yeah, the three classes we are having, class 1, class 2, class 3. Let me call this as, okay, let me have omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. There are total three classes here. And let me have the mean. Mean of them is somewhere here. Let me call this like mean of class 1. And let me call this, see this looks like mean, right? If you take average of these samples, roughly you may get somewhere here. If you take average of these samples, roughly you are going to get somewhere here. Similarly, if you take the average of these samples, you may get somewhere here. These are the means. Let me call this as mu 1 bar. What is the dimension of mu 1 bar? 2 cross 1, right? D equals to 2 here. In this example, D equal to 2. And this corresponds to mu 2 bar. This corresponds to mu 3 bar. For example, someone gave you the new input sample. Let me construct a new sample as follows. Okay, they gave some new input sample somewhere here. Will you classify this as omega 1, omega 2, or omega 3? You can apply this minimum distance classifier according to this rule, right? With these assumptions, where our likelihood function is generally Gaussian with equal covariance matrix for everyone, and they are independent features. And they are equally probable. Real probabilities are equal. All these assumptions, if you try to apply, you are going to end up with minimum Euclidean distance classifier. Minimum Euclidean distance classifier. Euclidean distance of this given input with respect to the means, right? Yeah, which one is nearer? Which mean is nearer to this?
Omega.
The target. This is my target x bar, x1, this is nearer, right? This is nearer compared to them, compared to this distance and this, okay, this distance. It means I'll try to assign a label of omega 1 for this. I'll assign like omega 1. This is my classifier output. Minimum distance classifier output. Suppose, okay, if I have somewhere here, how to classify? Is it nearer to omega 1, omega 2, or omega 3? Which class? That means, right? You need to look into means distance. I think these two are equal, right? These two distances are roughly equal. Let's say they are identical. Let's say far away, you can neglect this. Then which one will you consider out of omega 2, omega 3? See, in such cases, one blind method is randomly you can pick one out of these two. That's very rare case where you can find at equal distance from these means. It's very, very rare case. Just a two dimension. If you look into 1000 dimension or 1 lakh dimension, that's very, very rare case. It's almost not possible, such cases. At least for these cases, if you are able to find such thing, which is nearer, equally nearer to both, then you can randomly pick one out of those two. That's one method. Randomly pick either omega 2 or omega 3. That's your choice. Unless you are able to say that that's not belongs to omega 1. Yeah, that's fine. Okay, do you have any doubts? You can ask. Okay, any doubts? Oh, that's fine. When is your lab exams? Do you have Simon lab or Simon exams when you are having that one?
27.
27 is theory exams and lab exams. 27.
Sir, from 22nd, practical lab. Yeah.
Okay, 22nd hours practical lab. Okay. And when you are having that theory exam, is it decided?
Yes, sir. Like, my April 4th or near that.
Okay, yeah, that's fine. Oh, it's okay. Anyway, I'm going slow only actually. Okay. Yeah, any doubts?
Sir, indirectly you have considered ML rule, sir.
We have to consider.
Sir, indirectly you have considered the like, maximum likelihood function, right? Not MAP rule. Because you have neglected, like you have taken all the probabilities are equal, right?
Yes, the MAP rule is same as ML rule when the prior probabilities are equal. If you apply this condition, MAP rule is same as ML rule. If you want, you can eliminate in the starting itself. In the starting itself means, yes, that multiplication factor is there, right? Yeah, here itself you can eliminate. This one we are writing like P of omega j into this one. You can simply remove this term because it's a constant, right? Then you will end up with marginal likelihood. Yeah.
Sir, what
It's
if
very
the
basic.
probabilities are not equal?
If the probabilities are not equal, yeah. Can you try to map with your digital communications course? Will it go nearer to this or far away from this? Yeah. I'll try to help with pictures. Just go with two classes instead of three. See, 2 × 1 vector d equals to 2. If we are going with equal distance, that minimum distance classifier, or with P of W1 equals to P of W2, with this condition and along with those conditions, minimum distance, right? For example, can I call it as a boundary? Okay, I'll ask a question. Suppose my input vector x bar is somewhere here. Will you classify it as omega 1 or omega 2? If this is the case,
Omega.
minimum classifier, omega 1, right? If my x bar is somewhere here, will you classify it as omega 1 or omega 2?
Omega 2.
Omega 2, why?
Because that is like this is acting as boundary.
It's acting as a boundary, right? You can see what I am doing is I am simply joining mu 1 bar and mu 2 bar. Simply joining mu 1 bar and mu 2 bar vectors. And after that, I am writing perpendicular bisector for this. Indirectly, below this, all these points are nearer to mu 1 bar. Above this, all these points are nearer to mu 2 bar. That's what I am doing. I can call it as a decision boundary. Okay, for example, with P of W1, let's say 0.9. And P of W2 equals to 0.1. And then, okay, I'll try to draw two boundaries. Can you comment which one might be feasible for this case? This is boundary number 1. boundary number 2. Let me get a
Second one.
perpendicular one again. Which one?
Second one.
Second one looks feasible for you. Yeah, what is the reason why this looks good?
Because the probability is 0.1, less probability, so that less number of points can map to that one.
See, okay, actual intention behind this one is with high probability omega 1 may occur, right? Based on this. See, probability of occurrence of class 1 is 0.9, probability of occurrence of class 2 is 0.1. These are the prior probabilities. With high probability, you can expect this will be true. This will be true, right? With high probability. With less probability, this will be true. That's the reason. See, okay, I want to mess on this one. It's better to go with one. If you have
I got
100% clarity, yeah, let me
minus
have
two.
one. Let me have zero for this. Do you think this boundary will work
No, sir.
out? Or where can I keep my boundary? Can I keep my boundary somewhere far away? Somewhere this side, one and two. Okay, 3 and 4. Which one is preferable? I want to say left side of boundary, omega 1, right side of boundary, omega 2. That's my target. With this condition, will you prefer to have boundary 3 or boundary 4?
Four, sir.
3, oh, boundary 4. Okay,
Yes, sir.
boundary 4. Yeah, that's fine. If you are keeping the boundary somewhere here, and whatever x I wrote, for example, if I have given some x bar somewhere here, by default, you let classify it as omega 1, right?
Yes, sir.
Less than this boundary is omega 1. That means, irrespective of your x, you want to always consider this as a sample from your class 1, omega 1. That's what you are doing here. Because always, class 1 will occur, class 2 will never occur. That is already prior knowledge for you. Based on that, you are trying to keep the boundary much far away from this. That's what you are doing here. Yeah, such things will happen. It will go far away from you. That boundary will keep on going toward this as your P of W1 is increasing. If your P of W1 is increasing, what happens is this boundary will keep on moving right side. If your probability of omega 1 keeps on increasing, that thing will happen. This is intuitive way. Mathematically, yeah, anyhow, we'll try to solve in tomorrow's class the mathematical proof for that. This boundary will keep on moving this side. That thing you can guess if P of W1 is increasing. P of W1 is decreasing. That will go this way, that boundary. Yeah, any other doubts?
About assignment question, second question.
Okay, assignment 2, second question.
Sir,
Okay, do you have doubt in that?
like you have asked to compare the mean square errors of all the
Yes.
yeah, but like the we are getting the mean square we are getting the mean square error like infinite, sir, for all the three. First one is
Mean
some
square error
constant.
infinite? No, it's not possible, right? Oh, some mistake is there. Yeah, if you want, I can write a code and send to you. I'll write
Yeah.
the program for that one, that MATLAB program. I'll write it forward to you.
Okay, sir.
Yeah, no problem with that one.
Okay.
Yeah,
Thank you, sir.
what else? Yeah, that's fine. Thank you.